بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلي اللهم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين My dear brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This is your brother Abdul Salam Abu Usama. In my talk today, I will deal, as I have promised before, with the relationship between a man and his wife, or the wife and her husband, in the bedroom. And in Islam, that is. And this is much needed because the matter of sex between the couple has become a taboo. And it is creating a lot of frustrations, confusions, and a lot of problems in the Muslim world. In the non-Muslim world, they spoke about their sexuality, and now it's open, in the open. In the Muslim world, it's kept as a taboo. So much so that in some cultures, when the woman is pregnant, she shouldn't show that she is pregnant until before the baby is born. And I was one of these people in this culture, and I hated it. One day, my youth, nothing was happening, and I did see that my mother had like small little balloon, but you know, women get fat, so it's no big deal, and I didn't understand much. Until one day, they disappeared, and without also knowing, only when she came home, she brought a baby with her. And I stood up there and gobsmacked, and what is this? And all the children looking, and maybe you've been in that situation. If you haven't, maybe you've heard of someone that has been in that situation. Why say that? Because it's widely spread. Your brother, your sister, okay, and how did it come? Well, we got him from the hospital, and then the parents start lying to their children, which is absolutely horrible from day one. That shows you my mother. Even when I talked to my mother, one day my daughter wouldn't pray, and I don't know what I said, and I said to my mother, oh, she's got her menses, and my mother put her hand on her mouth and she lowered her head, and as if I've said something extremely horrible, and I go, what? She goes, my son, you've grown up in the West and you have always been different to everyone else around you. These things are private, we don't tell them. And so I leveled up with her and I said, I apologize, my mother, I will not say that again. And then I went there and yes, that is absolutely what it is. So this relationship between you and your wife, and so when I say you and your wife, so if you are you and your partner, let's put it this way so we get out of town. This way, if I say you and your partner, the sister is you, your partner is your husband. If it's the husband listening to this, then you is the husband, the partner is the wife. If you both are listening to this, which is absolutely brilliant, if you can do that, then you, each one of them, interprets it for himself, and the partner would be the other one. So that we start living, actually, the real life that Islam wants for us. My brothers and sisters, we have this somewhere wrong misconception. And that is, a Muslim, we tell people that Islam is happiness, and so many ayat and hadith pinpoint to the fact that Islam is a religion, it's a deen of happiness. But when it comes to the practice of Islam, we feel like we are miserable. We are so much apart that when a Muslim man meets a Muslim woman, it's like two trucks that met on the same track. It's going to be collision. It's going to be the end of the world. I've heard this when I called some of my friends in the old time. The woman would pick up the phone and I would say, Assalamu alaikum. I swear to Allah, she wouldn't answer my salam. They would keep silent on the other hand. And I would say, am I talking to somebody? No answer comes from the other end. And I thought to myself, we are more advanced than the Sahaba when it comes to these things. Take this other example. There is this brother's wife who works in a post office. When she comes to the masjid, I used to work Al-Muntad at that time, she would wear the niqab. Nobody sees her face, and mashallah, in the masjid. But when she gets to the post office works, she would remove her niqab to deal with the customers. That is fine and dandy if that is what she wants to do. I don't know why she hides from us and shows herself to other people. That goes beyond me, but guess where the worst bit is? When one day, like, she was working and nobody saw her, she was with her hijab and smiling to the people, guy, ladies, and all that kind of stuff. As soon as she saw, me coming there, guess what she did? She poured the niqab on her face. So when I got to her, I said, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, barely I could hear a salam back. And I thought to myself, MashaAllah. And I told her, I said, sister, I've been looking at you throughout this line, and you are all MashaAllah smiley customer service with every person out there, English, young, old, woman, man. You didn't do anything. And there I am, I come here, and you completely switch as if I was the tyrant, the tiger, somebody's gonna eat you. I said, sister, this is not what Islam is all about. She wouldn't even say a word to me. And obviously when she went to her husband, she complained to him, and she said to him that I was rude to her. So her husband came boiling, North African blood, so he came boiling to me, and I said, hey dude, this is what happens. I said, man, you need to educate your wife instead of coming and throwing a thing. I said, I just told her what was right and what was wrong. Now you deal with that information. We have a double standard. When we are with each other, Muslim woman, we tend to behave like we are angels. Yet, as soon as the Muslimology goes away and the non-Islamic world come in, we turn into a complete different people. This is like absolutely out of the world. This is rahama'un bainam. We have compassion between us. Ashidda'u ala al-kuffar. We are rough and tough on other people, not in attitude, like when we are in fight and things like that. Customer service is always a customer service. Come on, a Muslim, when you are with a non-Muslim, I've seen brothers when they talk to ladies at the cash till, I've seen Muslims when they open a door to an English lady, their attitude, and I wonder to myself, I wonder if they do the same thing with their wives, or if they do the same thing when they are in a Muslim country. I've been to Muslim countries. When I'm wearing the qamis, people treat me different than when I'm dressed up in a Western way. If that shows, it shows a disease in the heart. So don't be all fluffy, muffy, educated, sexy, hot, mashallah, with non-Muslim women. And when you come to your home, you suddenly become that pious man that even the word sex is a sin. And also you, my sister, when you go outside there and you dress in hijab and the repeller, it repels people from you. When you come home, don't keep wearing the hijab. I've seen the consequences of a woman wearing the hijab. It's a repeller to the testosterone world. Us. It repels us. Repels us. And then when I meet the brother, I tell him, hey, I called to leave a message for you. Back then there was not mobile phones, so internet or access or text, anything. We just had the phones. So when I say, I called you to say, and somebody answered, they go, it's my wife. And I said, well, I've said, assalamu alaikum. And he said, no, she's, you know, kind of like the pious type of lady. Well, actually, if she was a pious type of lady, she would observe what the Quran says. فَلَا يَخْضَعْنَا بِالْقَوْلِ. Let them not submit the way they speak. So when I say, assalamu alaikum, instead of her saying, wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah, I don't know how women put that slant on it to make it like sound extremely sexy, but she couldn't just say, wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah, meaning get to the point. This is the real practice, not keeping quiet and not be talking to myself, and I don't know if the other person has understood what I said or not. So much also in the male part, when they talk, they say, me and my ahl, me and my people, my family. When he's just talking about his wife, a lot of male Muslims there have a problem. North African, they have a problem mentioning my wife, Zoji. And it shows the level of their education. Rasulullah only mentioned this in the context of a hadith, and he means with it. But every sahabi know the names of the wives of Rasulullah, and there are some ahadith which I will mention, and all of them are authentic. You'll be totally surprised. So my brothers, when Ummuna Aisha radiallahu anha al-Bukhari, she says, Rasulullah, when he used to kiss me, he used to suck on my tongue. I mean, I probably if I said this to my mother, she would kind of like kill herself. Some other people, they say, yeah, that's him, he's a prophet, it's different. Well, that's a statement of disbelief. If we start that journey, he is a prophet, he is different, then let's apply it in the whole of Islam. Why do you only apply it in something that doesn't fit you? In this talk, my brothers and sisters, I will reveal all. I will speak openly. I will use, instead of using the private parts of the man and the woman, I will call that the intimate parts. Intimate parts is what is between your legs. But the breast and everything else, I will speak about that openly. Also, I use the terminologies that we are used to listening to hearing in this text here. Remember, a sahabiya came to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and there is a saying that a lot of people, they say, la haya'a fi din. There is no shyness in Islam. Actually, it's wrong. Islam is full, it's all of it is haya. Al-haya'u min ad-din. Al-haya is part of Islam. Shyness and being shy is part of Islam. But when it comes to learning, we ask any many questions. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had one day a woman from Al-Ansar who came to him to ask about her menstruation. And she explained to Rasulullah about the blood when it comes out from the intimate part of a woman. How would she do it? And this is a woman asking a man openly in front of people. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, you take a piece of cotton and you cleanse yourself and you follow the path. Meaning you go from the below until you get to the intimate part. And the Sahabiya said, how do I do that? Well, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not going to get into technicalities. So he said to one of his wives, he said, you explain to her. You explain, because now it's going to go to practical, to showing the woman, because with words she didn't understand. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam knew that this woman needed a visual explanation, and women are good at doing that. I, for instance, I cannot teach a woman how to kiss properly. But having taught my wife how to kiss properly, I would ask my wife to teach the other sister how to kiss properly. A lot of brothers don't know anything about foreplay, even though it is in Al-Quran. Allah has commanded man to observe the foreplay in sex before anything else. And man raised blah, 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 and they still don't do it. So there is that frustration. And the female is responsive in the bed. In the sense that if you, the man, the partner, knows how to take your woman to lead her in bed, it's going to be an extremely beautiful experience for you both. But a lot of people is just come here, open your legs, I'm in, out, that's it, done, I'm off, out of it. And the woman is left to frustration, and that frustration builds throughout the years until woman loses her ability to have sex properly, and the man starts reading into that, she doesn't fancy me, so I don't want to do it with her, and then problems start happening, and all that due to what? Ignorance. So what will I cover in these things? And really, these are just teasers. It's not what, it's more than one you can ever comprehend. I will even talk about positions. Have you ever heard of the G-spot? I will speak about that. Why should you listen to me in these things? A, I, alhamdulillah, I'm a qualified coach, and I've worked with couples throughout my life. From marriage counseling to sexuality to a lot of things. So alhamdulillah, I've taken more classes about sex education than probably you've read Quran. If you read Quran once a month, that is 12 times a year, I've taken more than that. And I've read so many books about that for various reasons. Another thing is, alhamdulillah, I hold a degree in psychology, NLP, neuro-linguistic programming. And I can tell you, my brothers, and this is besides my computer masters and a few other degrees that I got. Also Islamic education. I do have Islamic education. I did study under the leadership of few knowledgeable people and scholars and seekers of knowledge. So my dear brothers and my sisters, the question is here. Where do we want to go with this sexuality? Where are we headed to? So what can and cannot be done in Islam? Am I allowed to lick my woman's intimate part? Is she allowed to suck my intimate part? Can I do this? Can I do that? We'll deal with these things. How to improve my sexual life, where it is right now, and how you take it to the next level. How can you touch the breast of a woman so that it becomes an enjoyable part for you and for her? Al-Islam talks about al-istimta', deriving pleasure and leisure. Allah has created the woman a source of that. She has the power to offer us that element of desire. And pleasure is in the Quran, in the Sunnah. So why we're not using that? Why are we not getting the maximum out of it? Why are the non-Muslims, after so many years, they made so much studies about sexuality that they enjoy sex, and we Muslims that have the teachings in the Quran and Sunnah on how to be the best lovers in bed, we are the doomed ones. Many people, they only have sex now once a year, or maybe once every 2 years. There is no intimacy. The only time they get intimate is when the legs are open. That's the end of it. There is no cuddling time. Maybe a lot of male, from what I've heard, they don't have something called intimate time. Just cuddles. That's foreplay, erotic massage. Just this surprises nothing. Every time they get close, it ends up with sex. It doesn't have to be like that. So how to improve your sexual life? How to make it, give it a next, a new dimension? How can you avoid that element where your wife doesn't want to sleep with you anymore because she feels you are a loser? You don't even know how to handle an intimate part properly. All this can be taught and all this can be learned. Many men suffer from the much dreaded quick ejaculation. 1 second and he's out. and I will give you pointers, and I will help you improve your sexuality by a tremendous amount. How would you feel if you could go at sex with your woman 30 minutes, 60 minutes without coming once? How would you build up to actually have an orgasm at the same time? Have you experienced that actually? Tons of people have not. Tons of people don't know what a real orgasm is. Do you know that there are five types of orgasms? Have you ever managed to give your wife a full body orgasm? Do you know how to get it actually? Subhanallah, how come you are married for years and you don't know how to please your partner? No wonder we do have a lot of stress in our life. No wonder we have a lot of problems. Because let me tell you this, my brothers and my sisters. Sex is your messenger, the love messenger. When a healthy sexual life is there, the couple is in perfect harmony. The better the sexual relationship, the more harmonious the couple is. The first thing to suffer any dysfunctionality in a relationship is sex. You can actually, either a man or a woman, sense how close or how far your partner is from you by the kiss. By the way, when your lips get together. Do you know how to excite your lips? My brothers, subhanAllah. And then people, when they don't have that in bed, instead of go and learning from it and talk to professional people, they go on the internet and look at pornography. And that gives them, again, it locks them further into the depth of the tragedy. Also, how to prepare myself and my wife for the ultimate bedroom fun. How can you make every bedroom fun? Fun, not a chore. Not you're the wife, she's on her back, legs open, and all she's thinking about is, what am I going to shop today? I need to make my to-do list. Some sisters, they make their to-do list in that moment. Then, when the man is just closing his eyes, it's funny. And believe me, I'm not making up these stories. I've heard them from couples that I worked with in their matrimony problems. Many of them have actually survived that and they are feeling better. Two couples have named their children after myself, after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved their marriage because of me. So what can be said and what can you not say? Can I talk naughty to my wife? Can she talk naughty? Can my wife actually play with my intimate part? Can I play with their intimate part? I've heard a couple, she said, how can I put his intimate part into my mouth knowing that this mouth recites Al-Quran? And I said to myself, subhanAllah, the Quran itself tells you, do it. Now you're telling me you are more pious than the Quran? Al-Islam has prohibited two things, and I'll get this in details. No anal sex. Penetration of the anal sex, it is haram. Penetration. And to penetrate the woman in her intimate part when she has her menses, childbirth, nifas. These are the only two parts that are haram in Islam. What I will share with you will shock a lot of people. But actually, Islam prohibited only these two. If you feel fine, happy, and you are happy sucking on your woman's private part for the whole day, do it. Just make sure you don't waste your salat. That's something that Allah has made halal. And don't tell me I recite Quran with my mouth. You lie with that mouth and you say a lot of things about this mouth. One, when it comes to sexuality, we do impose. And we can't go and ask a sheikh. Because imagine the horror that, because remember, there is Islam and there is culture. The majority of Muslim sheikhs, when it comes to sex, are more culturally. I once read the fatwa of this great scholar, Sheikh Ibn Baz, alayhi rahmatullah, also Ibn Uthaymeen, when he was asked about oral sex. Can I suck my husband's intimate part or can I lick my woman's intimate part? And he said, no, it's not permissible because it's a place of dirt. Now look at that. And he goes, and dirt is harmful to the body and what leads to the harm of the body is haram. Subhanallah. And then he said, also as a Muslim, we should not copy the kuffar. You see how culture is playing here? Because Ibn Baz or Ibn Uthaymeen or any of these great scholars, alayhim rahmatullah, cannot say, yes, sucking is halal. Because it's just the way of the culture in Saudi Arabia or in Algeria or any countries of the world is that its sexuality is not ruled by Islam, it's ruled by culture. One day, as in al-Bukhari, also I'll get to this point, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the term, the ayah, نِسَاءُكُمْ حَرْثٌ لَكُمْ فَأَتُوا حَرْثَكُمْ أَنَّا شِئْتُمْ. Your nisa are just like a piece of land which the farmer would just farm. Okay, if you have a piece of land, and if you want to go horizontal, you go horizontal. If you want to go vertical, you want to go vertical. If you want to go oblique, you go oblique. You've got the animal and you've got that thing in front of you, and that's it, right? Any way you want. And your earth, you can plant in it whatever you want. So Allah has given us this example. نِسَاءُكُمْ حَرْثٌ لَكُمْ. Your women are like a piece of land that you are preparing to plant your crop. فَأْتُوا حَرْثَكُمْ. So do to your hearth, to your that piece of land, and نَشِئْتُمْ, as you like, as you please. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about the positions and what goes on in the matter of enjoyment, excluding the two elements. Anal sex is haram, approaching women in menstruation. And I will come to the exceptions of what can be done, what cannot be done in both of them. So a man from Mecca married a woman in Al-Madinah. And this hadith is authentic, subhanAllah. But again, I'll come back to this hadith because there is a lot we can learn from it. The man, when he married the woman in Al-Madinah, there are two cultures, and these are Sahaba. So the culture here is the clash. When the man wanted to approach his partner, he wanted to do it the doggy style, meaning taking the woman from the back, but the penetration in her intimate part. Not anal, intimate part. When he wanted to do that, the women in Al-Madinah, they were not used to this kind of sex. They had the missionary, as the name, missionary means mission, meaning do the job and get lost. That's how you make the baby the quickest. Woman on her back, the legs are up, that's all there is to it. And I will explain how you can make that more fun than just mission job. So when he wanted to take her from the back, the doggy style as they call, subhanAllah, it's either animal, but anyway, she wouldn't let him. She goes, no, you're not doing it the back style. You want to do it, I lie down on my back and you do it like we do it. That was the only position Al-Ansar in Al-Madinah did it. That was the norm. But Quraysh, they were adventurous in sex. The next day, the Sahabi didn't say anything. Where did he go? He went to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to ask him about the question. They went for the argument, to resolve the argument. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't say a word because he cannot speak out of himself. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is from Mecca. Now, if he didn't say anything about the traditions and the customs of the people of Al-Madinah, because he just doesn't know much about it. At that time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered that man with this ayah, نِسَاءُكُمْ حَرْثٌ لَكُمْ فَأْتُوا نِسَاءَكُمْ أَنَّا شِئْتُمْ وَقَدِّمُوا لِأَنفُسِكُمْ. How beautiful is that? So the Sahabi has got the answer, and the Ansar got the answer that it is time to expand your sexual horizons. There are more positions that you can make love in, that you can shake a stick at. And you can do it in the bathroom, in the kitchen. All these are halal within the four walls of your house. Everything goes. But we live in a world where taboo is taboo. We all live. And one thing is, I'm sorry to say this, but I am, alhamdulillah, separated with my wife, and I am in search of a woman to marry. Now, one of the questions I make sure that I want to make sure is that this woman does not mix between halal sexuality and the taboo world. Because I don't want to marry another woman and just to realize that I am marrying a pillow in the bed, and that I don't want to divorce again. And the sisters, because you are a brother, don't talk about sex. Do you fear Allah? Yes. Do you pray? Yes. Do you wear hijab? Yes. Then they are good. No. You must look at the compatibility along down the way. So my brother, how can I break free from the cultural obstacles? An English lady who was used to a pattern of life, she had a teenage hood, she had different sex experiences, and she married someone who doesn't educate her but straight away shuts her down from what to her was the norm. And then she doesn't know anymore how to behave, how to deal. Another culture, for example, Bengalis, they close. Pakistanis, name and don't be scared. Arabs, yeah, Allah, it's a lot of problems out there. So how can we break free from the cultural obstacles to get into the widest part of Islam? The more you learn, the better you will be. And in this talk here, I will talk about all of these. Learn the art of kissing. The art of kissing is a beautiful art. Now, let me tell you this. If you don't spend at least 20 minutes to half an hour in kissing before you get to the sex part, then you actually, you don't know what making love is. You're just fulfilling the duty of putting the sperm in the woman and move on. Kissing is a beautiful world. Yeah, it's a beautiful world. A lot of people don't know how to kiss properly, how to initiate the touch, how to use the lips as messengers to the brain that great time is ahead. I will teach you, inshallah, how to kiss properly. Lots of you have heard about the French kiss, but do you know what actually French kiss is? Do you know how to trigger it? Why it's called the French kiss? Why not the Italian kiss? Why not the Arab kiss? What makes it? Some people, the moment you put their lips in contact with their lips, they shove their tongue in your mouth. What's that? What do you think the woman would feel about that? It's not about shoving your tongue into her mouth. It's the contact. It's again, I'll get into more details about the art of kissing in time. Also, my brother introducing the art of touching. And this one is a vehicle to a mutual bliss. How can you touch? What part? We live in an age of science. They discovered what part of our body is sensual, sexual, smooth, nice. Which part, what velocity, what pressure can you press? Which fingers, how do you move your fingers? All this. I think I will offer seminars, inshallah, to brothers. But these seminars, you gotta pay for them, to attend them, to learn for this. Because I've realized anything free, nobody turns up. But how to move your fingers? How can you actually, have you ever given your wife an orgasm just by touch? Do you know how to massage her intimate part? Do you know how to give her a vaginal massage just with your fingers? With your hand? Do you know that? Do you know how to give your wife an orgasm, an intimate vaginal orgasm with your tongue only? Your lips? You don't know. You don't know. And I feel sorry for you. You're missing a big deal on what Allah has created. Today we live in a society. That society is geared towards the independence of women. And I'll speak about this. How was women before and after a revolution of the 60s, the hippies movement. That was the year I was born. Not 60, but the 60s. And also how was sex before that? How was sex before Islam? How Islam regulated sex? All these are going to come. You can email me your questions or you can send them to me on WhatsApp. And also something else about sex, the frequency of sex. The frequency of sex. Do I do it once a week? Twice a week? Once a month? What kind of hormones do I need in my body so that I perform good? Do I get aroused with my wife? What should I eat? Is there any tablets? Are there any herbs, Viagra or anything else that can help? The woman, how does she dress? How would a man feel when he comes home and his wife is in hijab? How can you live when your wife doesn't smell good? When the man comes home and he smokes outside, how does he expect his wife? When he comes home and he's not nicely dressed, would you be better than Abdullah ibn Abbas? One day a sahabi entered and he found Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anh oiling his hair and beautifying himself, putting also the black mascara in the eyes and things like that. Mascara, did you call it? The one that you use, the pencil. Anyway, the kuhl. Al-kuhl. Oh, yeah, it's called kuhl in English also. The man looked at Abdullah ibn Abbas horrified and mortified. You can find this in Tafsir ibn Kathir in the ayah. وَلَهُنَّ مِثْلُ الَّذِي عَلَيْهِنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَلَهُنَّ and to them that which is requested of them. And the man said to Abdullah ibn Abbas, he said, yeah, Abdullah ibn Abbas, knowing you who you are, I will not go out of this house until you give me an evidence from the Quran and the Sunnah that what you are doing is halal, meaning cutting up yourself for your woman. And Abdullah ibn Abbas told him, Ya ibn Akhi, son of my brother, this is how they would call her. Because don't you read in Al-Quran, وَلَهُنَّ مِثْلُ الَّذِي عَلَيْهِنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ Don't you read in Al-Quran when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and to them that which is expected or upon them, al-ma'ruf, with what is known. The man said, yes. He goes, don't I expect my woman to look sexy for me? He goes, yes. He goes, then it's her right that I look sexy for her. Have you ever, my brother, asked your wife, tell me, what it is that I dress that you find me sexy? Dead sexy, gorgeous, hot, that you can't put your hands on me? I'm sure none of you has ever asked that question to your wife. You force, you don't care how she feels. Have you ever really made it a point to make love to your wife, not wait until necessity comes? i.e., you agree with your wife on Thursday night, we're going to have me or our time, and then she takes her time to beautify herself. Why don't you take a shower together? Why don't you get sensual in the shower? Why? We have kids. Not an excuse. I can show you guys on how to do it without worrying about kids. So my brothers and my sisters, these things here, we have to understand a lot of things about our sexology. So how to do it the best way we want to do it. Some of these talks, inshallah, will be filmed, but until now we are not fully prepared to film for the lack of other things. And I have asked many of you to donate. A few of them have, the majority hasn't. And I feel sorry for you. Wallah, I feel sorry, and to Allah I complain the lack of the cooperation of Muslims today. Subhanallah. It's a matter of belief. You donate where you believe, and if you believe a cause is not worth enough, and I really, really make dua to those brothers and sisters that have donated for this cause. Really have. And that's what differentiates us Sahaba, is they believe, they donated. Many people here listen and they don't donate. That means they don't believe. And that's how I see it, and that's how it is. But anyway, sex. My brothers and sisters, sex is beautiful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded women outside in the street to cover themselves because women are absolutely gorgeous. To us men, any man with his testosterone in place would desire a lot of beautiful women. And Allah has created the tall, the short, the fat, the ugly. It's created everyone. But at the end of the day, nobody is ugly. We all have our beauty that only time will deliver. Women today have become independent, and Muslims women have fallen to that, and that's why there are lots of divorce. Before, a woman didn't have any source of livelihood except through her husband. He was her government, he was the donor. So women back then in time didn't rebel against the slightest small thing, because she learned on how to prioritize things. I can live with this, because if I don't do this, I'm going to lose this, I'm going to leave the house, and la la. Today in England, what do we have? Women get benefit, we get child benefit. A lot of people are happy to get child benefit. Actually, it's a bad thing. What it's doing, yes, in the long term, in the short term, it gives you money in the bank. But in the long term, as the relationship moves from a rabbit stage, i.e. when you have sex a lot, and then when you settle into a lifestyle, the woman starts thinking very dangerously. They will say, okay, why do I need this man in front of me? Just that he comes here and tells me on and off and do this. Why do I need him? Recently, I'm visiting a couple, and I was gobsmacked. I hardly ever stress over an issue. In my dunya, I can be completely broke. I don't have a house. Everybody hates me. I don't care about, well, they don't bring me down. But when I heard that this couple was married 8 years, the man has the bank account, only him knows what's in the bank account. The woman knows not how much he has in the bank account. He gives her £50 a month. £50 a month. I was totally disturbed until now when I see it. How can that be? To completely exclude the wife? Guess what? The woman starts thinking. Now she wants divorce. She goes, you know what? I can have a bank account of my own. I lived very honored by my dad when I was in my house, when I was in my home. My dad gave me everything. And when I'm married, I got nothing. I have to wait £50 a month. This is a crime in the name of humanity. I don't mention Islam. And then she says, I can have my own bank account. I can control my finance. I can actually have the hand to buy what I want, go where I want. I can control it. I can spend it. I can invest it. I can buy with it what I want. Sexuality? Well, my husband is not good in bed anyway. I can go down to Ann Summers, where they sell all this beautiful lingerie there, and there is a hidden corner there, and there is a hidden corner there. Guess what? They sell dildos, and they sell, handcuffs, and they sell a lot of goodies there. You know what? The woman says, okay, I can buy a dildo. What, penetration? I've got something that replaces a man, and it does a job better than a man. At least I can get an orgasm. It's not 2 minutes and off, go. And I don't have the smell, the bad smell of the guy. I don't have. My brothers, you understand. And the man, what he does, when his woman is not responding to him, he goes to the internet, watches and masturbates. And then starts looking at women outside in the street. And where are we going with this? So my brothers and my sisters, if any of you couples out there are having difficulties, don't keep it to yourselves. This man tells his wife, she can't tell anyone of the problems they're having. She's stuck at home. This is emotional abuse. I've seen this in my life. For 30 years that I've worked with couples, Muslims or non-Muslims, the problems with Muslims are horrible. The problems with non-Muslims are a lot less problematic, subhanAllah. And with non-Muslims, it's easy to reason and get to a goal quicker than the blocked brains of the Muslims. How can you? I can't come back from, what is the problem in having a joint bank account with your wife? What is the problem of you taking your wife to Ann Summers? What is the problem of you telling your wife, you know what, I love those panties. I really love that corset on you. Oh, this mini skirt is beautiful. It looks like, what is the problem? She's feminine. She's sexual. Allah created her like that. Women appreciate femininity and appreciate men when they love and they appreciate their femininity. If your woman is not performing properly with you, the problem is in you. You have changed her from her own organic creation that Allah has created. My brothers and my sisters, we got married for two reasons. لِيَسْكُنْ السُّكُونَ. السُّكُونَ is to find the comfort, peace, serenity, safety, love, desire in that woman. And two is to ensure the continuity of mankind, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. If you live one without the other, you are not fulfilling your duty on earth. I.e., if you marry only to produce kids, then you are missing on a big thing. And if you marry just for sex, then there is a huge problem with that as well. Men today don't find pleasure in women anymore. And they resorted to what? To the disease of homosexuality. Women don't find pleasure in men anymore. And that's why they go into lesbianism. Muslims, you can't go like this and we can't go like that. A woman, and then problems start happening. We start closure happening. Problems happen. The world of sexuality between a couple is far, far bigger than you can ever comprehend. And this is why you understand when Islam prohibits masturbation for male and female. It's not the act itself that's the problem. It's the consequence of problems. If I start masturbating now, why do I need a woman? If the woman can have the pleasure from a dildo, why does she need a man? Why? So Islam tells you, do not touch these intimate parts of you except from what Allah has created to touch it. Your woman can masturbate you. Let's say she has her menses and you feel horny and you want to sleep with your wife. You are totally aroused. You can kiss, you can do whatever you want. And at that moment there, because you can't do penetration, your woman can masturbate you. It's absolutely halal. No scholars on earth will tell you it's haram. And you can give an orgasm to your woman and masturbate her with your hands. But she can't touch you herself. She can't touch herself because of the consequences, the result of all this. Let me ask you, my brothers, when was the last time you actually gave an orgasm to your woman? When was the last time she gave you an orgasm? By hands, by mouth. We do have a lot to learn that is halal in Islam. A lot of Muslims men, they are married with Muslim women, but they can't express their freedom in sexuality with their women because of a fear of being judged or being put in a corner or turned down. They actually go and look for English girls and sleep with them, or European girls, and do with them what they should be doing with their wives. But they feel free. There is a song written by Brian Adams, I Run to You. And I'll tell you the story, because we used to perform at concerts before. I know the ins and outs of that song. And that song couldn't speak really, it spoke really the truth of what a lot of Muslims do. If you can get the lyrics on the internet, just go and write Brian Adams, Run to You. And you, a lot of men would run to non-Muslim women, prostitutes. I see lots of prostitutes in Brick Lane, lots of where the Bengali community lives. Why is that? I saw a lot of Bengali men going with prostitutes, paying them money. And many of them are married. So what is the problem? Can't your wife be as sexy as the other wife? So from here, my brothers, it's 40 minutes here, so I gotta stop soon. This is just an introduction. In my next talk, bi-idhnillah tabaraka wa ta'ala, I will tell you what you can do. Well, we started, it's a series of talks, and I will hold, inshallah, seminars of this. I will submit a form, and these seminars can be attended by brothers and by sisters and by couple, and I encourage you both, because you take knowledge and you go home. home and apply it. I will post, inshallah, the details about this seminar, the fees and everything soon. Sex is beautiful. Wallahi al-azim, it's beautiful. It's more beautiful that you can comprehend. And if you cannot, and if you are not enjoying it, or if it's not gonna, if you're gonna live in the customs, you are going to miss 90% of your life in nothing. We have lots of fake brothers out there, and we have lots of fake sisters out there, and then when they get married, and another fake marriage, and the fake sex, and fake this. Piety, we know, when you are not pious, is when you do certain things, none of which has been lick your woman's intimate part or suck your husband's intimate part. It never. These two, they are not sins. They don't attack your piety because it's only known by Allah. And in Al-Quran, Allah has spoken about a beautiful thing. When divorce comes and people get their mouth and they start to hurt each other, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about, remember when you got naked in front of each other. The most of who you are appears when you are in sex. That moment when you have the orgasm, when you scream and you shout and you tense up, and when the woman scratches your back, and when she gives you that hickey, and all these things. It's a beautiful world out there, man and sister. Why are you wasting it under the pressure of culture? Please, please, for all love of Allah, this, our 60s are going to happen now, but they are going to happen in the halal. I will, be in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the next talk, the next installment, speak about different relationships that were before Islam. Orgies and wife exchange and all this, and prostitutes, all of them were in Mecca before Islam. At the time when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there were sex parties in Mecca and all these things. It's unbelievable. And Ummuna Aisha tells us more about this in Sahih Bukhari. There is a lot of knowledge out there that a lot of people don't know, not because it's not there, it's because it's there, nobody reads. Like just orgies, sex parties, swingers parties that are happening here in Europe now, and they are in the open. Do you know that they used to happen in Mecca? And Rasulullah lived his 40 years that he lived in Mecca. Well, he didn't go, I'm not saying he goes, but he was aware that they happened in Mecca. And there was even a service back then. They were prostitutes, but these prostitutes, you couldn't have sex with them, but anything else goes. Yeah, Allah, I pray to you to give us more. I'm going to start a podcast, and I'm going to start also a few other things in internet radio and some things like that, so where you can come and listen and give your things. So stay tuned, my brothers and sisters. It's going to get fun. One day you will have an orgasm with your wife, so powerful, so strong, so beautiful. It doesn't matter how many years you've been married, and it doesn't matter how many kids she has, and it doesn't matter how well you are in your relationship. Everything can be renewed. You just need to know how, and I am your how. Alrighty, be happy. Something is going to change your life. And I pray to Allah to bless me, you, and give you the best woman, or make you the best woman for your man. Look forward, don't look backward. Time has come to change, and we will all change to the better. وصلي اللهم على نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم, who was the best kisser. Yes, he was the best kisser, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Ummul Aisha will explain his way, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Subhanak Allahumma wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa an. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. This is again your brother, Abdul Salam, Abu Usama. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.